Hi everyone, this is Gordon, the game designer at Mighty Box, and I'm here to give you an overview of Posthuman Sanctuary's gameplay. As some of you might be aware, Posthuman Sanctuary is the digital incarnation of the Posthuman board game, which was released at the end of last year. You can find out more about the board game through the link below the video. While both games have the same core system, there are significant differences in how they play. We wanted to go a few steps beyond just porting the board game into digital platforms and really bring the Posthuman world to life. The digital version of Posthuman is a single-player game. The aim is to reach Sanctuary, a rumored fortress housing a sizable community of, hopefully, friendly humans, without dying or turning mutant. You start off by creating your character. You give your character a name and choose their gender. Then you move on to building your character's stats and skills. This is fairly straightforward. You have a set number of development points to spend on upgrading stats and buying skills. The higher the stat, the more expensive the next point is. The more skills you have, the more expensive the next skill is, and so on. For each skill you buy, you need to choose one of three skill types. Combat skills give you new actions and abilities to use in combat situations. Social skills help you manage your followers better and aid you in narrative situations, which there are a considerable amount of in the game. Survival skills give you abilities that come into play, for the most part, while performing actions on the map. As you progress in the game, you will gain development points and will be able to develop your character by upgrading their stats and buying new skills. Next, you will select your starting equipment and weapons. You start off with 10 food and can spend any number of these on items. As you play the game and complete certain encounters, you will unlock new starting items and equipment that will appear in the screen next time you die and make a new character. If you die or turn mutant, it's game over. Finally, you will choose three special locations that you may find on your travels. These are helpful locations that are shuffled into your pile of map tiles that may be drawn and represent spots you have vague directions to and are trying to reach on your way to the fortress. Whether you like it or not, you have a certain quality that draws others to you. Throughout the game, you will meet people that will offer to join you on your travels. Needless to say, there is strength in numbers, but there are also challenges. But more on this later. Your journey takes place on a tiled map. Each tile represents a region with a type of terrain, a population level, and a loot factor. Each terrain type yields different types of loot. Forest tiles, for example, yield more food than any other tiles, but are the least likely to yield weapons and ammo. Urban tiles, on the other hand, are the most likely to yield weapons, but have the least food, which makes them dangerous to traverse unless well stocked on food. Each circle on a tile represents a zone which takes a day to travel through. In order to complete the trek to the zone, you need to complete all encounters that you come across on that day. You reach Sanctuary and your goal when you complete 20 of these zones. Each day, you can choose to perform one of four actions: scout, move, forage, or camp. In order to plan your journey, you can take a scout action. Scout actions allow you to draw a number of tiles equal to the exits on your current tile and place them in any legal position you like. This gives you a wider choice of destinations when you actually do move into them. Certain survival skills are triggered during scout actions, giving you additional benefits. For example, the map making skill allows you to draw one extra map tile than the number of exits on the current tile, choosing the ones you prefer and discarding the extra one. You can also move without scouting, in which case you draw a tile and simply move into the first zone of the map. The move action also allows you to move from one zone to the next on the same tile. Once you complete a tile, you can forage it for food and supplies. While this does not yield as much loot as when you complete the tile, it allows you to supplement the loot you have just scored or keep searching for the loot you had hoped for but did not find. Some survival skills trigger during foraging actions. The hunting skill, for example, allows you to make a shooting skill test, which, if successful, yields you one extra food. Camping allows you to stop and rest. This increases the party's health and at times morale. The camping action allows you to perform a single camping skill of your choice. These tend to help your party morale, health, or loyalty and include skills such as psychology, storytelling, surgery, and others. Food is a scarce resource in the post-human world. At the end of each day, you will need to eat one food or go hungry. If you go hungry, you will suffer loss of morale and health, and eventually will reduce the character's effectiveness in whatever they do. Followers will blame you for going hungry, causing their loyalty towards you to drop. Their loyalty towards you will also flag in various situations in the game when they feel you did not act in their best interests, or if they disagree with a decision you took. If the loyalty of your followers drops below a certain level, they will start behaving erratically, refusing to follow orders in some situations and potentially leaving the group altogether. Character psychology is thus a crucial part of post-human. It also plays a central role in the game's story encounters. While traveling across the post-human world, you will come across a variety of story-based situations that will require you to make decisions that will affect your followers' perspective of you as a leader, as well as influence future events in the game. These story segments will give you a selection of ways to respond to the situation at hand. Let's have a look at one such story situation. In the story segment, you are traveling through a patch of forest on a rainy day. You spot a house through the foliage and decide to take shelter in it. Upon entering, you find the place in shambles. As you're in the kitchen, rummaging through cupboards for food, you hear a whimpering noise coming from close by, and upon searching the kitchen floor, you find a trapdoor. You lift it and discover a woman holding a baby at the bottom of a cellar, both showing signs of mutation. You are given a choice to close the trapdoor and have one of your followers guard it. Open fire on them or give them some food. Let's say you decide to take pity on them and give them some food. You lose 1 point of food. That choice might also have an effect on events later on in the game, but I'll let you discover those for yourself. Kumal's defining psychology trait is kindness, and so he is happy with your decision, increasing his loyalty by 4 points. Gary's defining psychological trait is selfishness. Not a good combination of followers. Gary complains and loses 4 points of loyalty. Here we picked followers with opposing traits to give you an idea how the system works, but there are other traits that wouldn't have as strong bearing on the decision. So it really depends on the perspectives of the followers in your party. What's important for us is to give you a sense that these are people you are traveling with, not automatons that do your bidding uncritically and people are, well, difficult. While story segments are common in post-human, there are times when you'll just be in the sights of enemies that have no interest in getting to know what a fantastic solo you can roll out on your ukulele. Combat encounters are turn-based and take place on a battle screen split into 5 panels. Each battle screen has a different visibility value, which indicates how many panels ahead of them a character can see. In this case, 3. This value is modified by terrain and current weather conditions. The battle screen also has a cover value. This indicates the level of protection a character will get when taking cover. Here we have a cover value of 1, which means that enemies shooting at characters in combat will have their die complement reduced by 1. Each character and enemy can perform one action per turn. Characters start with 4 basic actions: move, melee, shoot, and take cover. Let's take a look at this combat here, for example. Lee, Gary, and Kumal are facing 3 mutants, a slicer, a tackler, and a listener. The player's party has the highest average speed, so they move first. Gary and Kumal move up 1 panel. They each have pistols and won't be able to reach the combat. Lee, our main character, has a rifle with a range of 3, so she is out of range at the moment. We expect the enemies to move forward and we don't want to get her in danger, so we'll leave her where she is. We can use Gary and Kumal as a buffer to protect her from the mutants and get her to pick off targets from a distance. The tackler and slicer move up. It's the second turn. Gary has the marching fire skill, which gives him this special action. Marching fire allows him to move 1 panel and shoot, but it knocks a dice from him. Gary shoots at the tackler and hits him for 3 damage. Kumail moves one panel forward. Lee takes a shot at the slicer. She hits for 5 damage, which is not enough to kill him. The slicer moves forward and is now within melee range, but he cannot attack this turn. His special skill, Double Strike, is a bit of a worry though. This means that he can attack both Gary and Kumail next turn if they remain in the same panel as him, both with one action. It's the enemy's turn. The tackler's special action, Tackle, allows him to move one panel and attack. Tackle does not do any damage, but it forces the target, in this case poor Gary, to take a speed test. If he fails, he loses a melee dice for this and next turn. The listener performs his special action. He plays confusion on Gary and succeeds in reducing his complement of shooting and melee dice by another 1 dice for the next round. Gary is down 2 dice next turn, which is not good. Things are getting a bit hairy for our party. Turn 3. Let's move Kumail first. It's time for us to make a move on that listener, or he's going to make things difficult in combat. Once you're in the same zone as an opponent, you are considered to be engaged. Getting out of an engaged zone requires an evade roll. Evade rolls work similarly to melee rolls, with the difference that the complement of dice rolled depends on your speed and not your melee skill. The nice thing with Kumail is that he has the dodge skill, as well as a high speed value, which gives him an extra evade dice. He also has a sprint skill, which gives him the sprint action and allows him to move 2 panels instead of 1. We thus select sprint and break out of the panel. Kumail manages to slip past the slicer and tackler and is now in the listener's panel. Nowhere to hide, big head. Gary is a more skillful fighter than the tackler, normally rolling 4 dice to the tackler's 3. But since he has 2 dice less this turn, he'll still be at a disadvantage. Things will be even more dire if he gets attacked, since the outnumbering sides gets a bonus dice when they attack. They do not gain this when they are being attacked, however. Melee combat is oppositional. This means that both attacker and defender roll their complement of melee dice and then their results are compared. The side with the highest remaining attacks deals damage on the losing side. Both sides deal damage to each other if they roll an equal amount of attacks. Gary could also try to break out of the engaged zone, but this will require him to make an evade roll, and with his low speed of 5, he only gets to roll a single die. I figure it's better for him to go for the weaker of the two opponents and take him out, so he can have a better chance of defending against the slicer. So Gary attacks the tackler, 2 dice on 3, and is lucky enough to get 2 hits against the tackler's 2 misses and 1 hit. Gary deals enough damage to kill the tackler. Lee is in a pickle. Lee can either move up one panel, pass, or shoot into the melee. If she does so, she has a chance of hitting Gary. I'm worried about the slicer's attack, so she's going to go ahead and shoot into the melee, hopefully killing off the lethal slicer. Unfortunately, she hits Gary for 5 damage. Gary is not happy about this and his loyalty drops by 2. The slicer attacks Gary, but now he has no outnumbering dice, which is just as well, since Gary is still confused from the listener, rolling only 2 dice against the slicer's lethal 4 melee dice. The slicer's roll includes a critical hit, increasing the damage he deals to Gary to 11. Not good at all. The hit gives Gary a mutation point. The listener attacks Kumail in melee. He rolls 2 melee dice while Kumail has 3. Kumail beats the listener with his counter attack and kills him. Go Kumail. Turn 4. Gary can't take another hit. Lee shooting into the combat is too risky. Breaking out of the zone is too risky with his low speed. Our best bet is to get Kumail to sprint over to Gary, giving him an extra melee dice, and hoping that that will be enough to kill the slicer. We move Kumail. Gary rolls his attack, and it's a successful attack for Gary. He deals enough damage to kill off the slicer, and our party is safe. That was a close one. A quick side note before we conclude. During the combat, we saw Gary gaining a mutation. I'm sure a lot of you out there that have played the board game are wondering how this works in Posthuman Sanctuary. Unlike the board game, you do not keep on playing if you turn mutant. Instead, you lose the game and have to start again. Sorry. The mutation system here is somewhat different from the board game. Each time you get hit in melee by a mutant, there is a chance that you will get a mutation point. There are also story encounters that give mutations. These mutation points are marked on the character screen of the victim and are assigned to either mental or physical mutations, sometimes randomly, sometimes according to situation. When the meter hits the manifestation symbol, the character gains a mutation, like Gary got in this combat. Vaccines can be used to lower the mutation level, but any mutations gained are kept. The total number of mutations a character has will contribute to the visibility of the party. The higher the visibility level, the more likely it is that the people and mutants you meet on your travels will react to your mutation. We won't go into how, as this will spoil aspects of the game, but let's just say it being a bad thing or a good thing depends on who you meet. Right, so that's an overview of how the game works. There are a lot of things we obviously cannot reveal at this stage, as they would ruin the game for you. But trust us when we say there's a rich story woven into the game that is partly set by us and partly evoked by the choices you make in the game. Thanks for watching, and we sincerely hope you like the game. Feedback in the comment section, welcome. Thank you.